and award reel two.
As they were told, the Sea Harrier team from Hermes were told by the Admiral's staff to stay up at high level over San Carlos water area and were not even asked to try to intercept enemy aircraft until the enemy had been through the target and delivered their weapons against the ships. Then, in the Admiral's own words in his book, they were to swoop down like hawks on the tails of the enemy and shoot them down. Well, this was astonishing, an astonishing revelation to me when I read the Admiral's book, and I said, my God, is that what they were doing? Because that's closing the door after the horse has bolted in the worst possible way. Unfortunately, they didn't try and interfere with the way Invincible aircraft conducted the defense of San Carlos, because I wouldn't have had any of it. I would have said, no, we're not doing it. Like, for example, I mean, we didn't obey the orders about the radar. We ignored them. But we were operating at low level between the threat or the possible approach directions of the threat and the San Carlos ships. And as such, we're providing quite a good deterrent. Now, that would be much better to deter more strongly and more robustly than to say, okay, haven't we shot down a lot of aeroplanes? But yeah, I mean, for example, on May the 21st, when Ardent was struck, she was struck away from our protection initially. She was down south of Falkland Sound, quite a long way south. And then she was hit by an air attack, and she was making her way north slowly, under her own steam, to get back to the fold, to the other ships around San Carlos. And her captain, Alan West, a brilliant guy, not an aviator, but I mean, he drove his ship like a bloody fighter pilot. He knew everything about what goes on up there and around him. I mean, he should have been a bloody admiral or JJ. But there he was, smoking away, and I'd already seen Ardent earlier in the day. And after one of our intercepts, where my number two and I, we shot down some Mirages, I looked up and I saw these little white dots which looked like seagulls orbiting between me and San Carlos. I was to the west of San Carlos. And while I was joining up with Steve, I suddenly realized they were aircraft, they weren't seagulls, and about 10 miles away. And they turned out to be skyhawks, Navy skyhawks, who were saying, where should we go? What should we do? And then suddenly they stopped circling and headed south, and I said, Christ, they're going for Ardent. Well, at that stage, I presumed that the Hermes cap station, that just to the south of San Carlos with a cap station to the west and to the northwest. The southerly one was at that stage manned by Hermes aircraft from, Sea Harrier aircraft from Hermes, red section. I didn't know they were up there. I didn't know until after the war that they were always up there, because we were talking about quite a big area of distance between cap stations. And so I head off with Steve across the countryside to try and intercept these Skyhawks before they got to Ardent. Or to assist. And on the way, I called Minerva, the control ship, and said, get red section down fast, basically, or in there fast. Tell them that there are three A4s going for Ardent. Well, they did come down from above. As I came out over the water, I was sucked. That means I was too far behind the A4s to get them myself. And there was Ardent. There were the A4s going across the water at low level. And suddenly, just before they hit Ardent, I saw one aircraft, one Sea Harrier, come in, fire a sidewinder, knock out the trail man. Then the middle man exploded. But the lead man got his bombs away into Ardent before clipping the mast and later shooting, you know, coming down around the corner in Stanley. But my point, which isn't 100% certain, but the big point is, if the Sea Harriers had been at low level where they should have been, in my view, and where we would have been when we were on cap, and were always, those Skyhawks would not have gone for Ardent. They'd have gone home. And so the staff's direction to Hermes of what they should be doing, attack, come down onto them after they'd done their business, was, in my view, I don't know how to describe it. I don't want to accuse the man of anything other than incompetence. It was certainly incompetent. I don't think it was any form of negligence, it was just ignorance. But the man and his staff were so self-assured about being intellectually superior beings, that's what he calls himself in his book, that's why I'm an admiral, I'm intellectually superior. he didn't listen to his experts and the accredited and track record experts down there at the time, myself and my team, because we'd done everything, all the trials, the whole lot. We knew our aircraft backwards, and we'd had very good results, complemented by the American fleet in a big NATO exercise. I mean, really strongly complimented. We did so well. And the guy wasn't listening, the Admiral and his team. They just basically told us to wind our necks in, do as we were told. Well, actually, as my book shows, we didn't do as we were told on many issues, because if we had done, there would have been worse results than there actually were in the war. And so when we talk about that first comment I made about inter-squadron rivalry, well, there was a lot of it there, in that we were pissed off, excuse the language, but absolutely pissed off that the Hermes team weren't doing their stuff. Now, they had been given extra pilots like we had at the start from the headquarters squadron, and those extra pilots were Neil Thomas, Tony Ogilvie, and Gordy Batt, I think. Yeah, Gordy Batt. But also there was an observer, not a pilot there, called Desmond Hughes, who'd been working for me for the last 3 years, training people on radar and systems, and was a really red-hot character. Now, these guys were trying to run the whole show over there because the squadron command had given up fighting, given up trying to argue with the flag. All the functions that were normally done by a senior pilot of a squadron were being done by Desmond Hughes, the observer, because neither the senior pilot Blissett nor the boss Old would go up to the captain and say, "I'm sorry, sir, this isn't on. You've got to have a word with that admiral. We can't use this like this. You're wasting assets." There was none of that. I mean, I was up to my captain so many times, and he never did anything but listen, balance, use his own judgment as a gunnery officer and logic, and say, "Okay, Sharkey, you're right. I'll have a word." And him having a word with the admiral was like talking to a brick wall most of the time, but at least he was almost the same seniority as the admiral, and he could talk. But Lynn Middleton was also almost the same seniority, the flag captain of Hermes. Now, if the Sea Harrier team in Hermes had got a message across to the boss, to the captain, strongly, then I'm sure Lynn would have stood up and be counted and said, "Admiral, I'm sorry, you can't do things this way. You give me a task, my boys a task, they'll do it properly." I mean, we were tasked to do things specifically, and occasionally we didn't... any time we got specific instructions, they were basically wrong. They were silly, and so we did the Dar way. But on one occasion, we got tasked to attack four helicopters stationed on Mount Kent at a particular reference position at dawn with 1,000-pound lay-down bombs. This is on the side of a bloody mountain. But it wasn't just like that. They also said, you are to go in at low level along this route, go out on a northerly heading along this route. And at the end they said, "Oh, by the way, there are three radar-controlled AAA air defense guns in the area. Watch out for them." The signal arrived late on board, after dawn. We're supposed to do the thing at dawn. I rushed up to Flyco when I heard about it, and I said, "Look, this signal is wrong. I mean, it's not the way to do it. Don't tell me how to do a job. Tell me to do the job." And we had quite an argument with Wings, my commander air, who said, "Sharkey, just get on with it and do it." And I basically said, "No, I won't. I want the position of those air defense guns." They knew exactly where the guns were, but they hadn't told us. They'd told us a track to come in. That's up to us to choose that, not the admiral's staff, because they knew nothing. Or by this stage, we knew how much they knew. They knew zero about how to operate Sea Harrier or anything to do with their warfare. So I said, "I'm not going to be told how to go in or leave the target area. I want to know where the threat AAA guns are. And we shouldn't be using 1,000-pound bombs, retard. Because if you do that, you've got shrapnel all over the place. You're on the side of a mountain. It's the wrong weapon." I said, "You've got to use 2-inch rockets, which is an aerial weapon designed to do just this job against targets like helicopters. 2-inch rockets and guns." And, of course, basically, the captain agreed with me and said, "Find the intelligence Sharkey wants." But Wings wouldn't agree with me about the bombing, low-level bombing. So, as you see in the book, I fudged it. I got the MAC man to come up with a report that there's a lot of fog and low cloud, and we won't get through at low level. So it's okay, we're going to do a high-level delivery, because we could do a very accurate high-level delivery with bombs, and we did it. I don't think the helicopters were there anyway by that time, but because they'd gone, we got the signal late. But the whole point of why I bring it up is the Admiral's staff telling us what to do, how to do something, but they were telling us the wrong things. If they got it nearly right, we'd have said, okay, that looks fine, that's where the target, you know, the danger points are. Good, we can avoid those. But no, they didn't give the right information. Not at one stage throughout the Falklands fighting did the Admiral's staff give us, in Invincible, one scrap of enemy intelligence. Not at one time. Not once. And they were getting stacks of information in from the SS boys ashore and the SBS boys ashore on special operations and from the land forces later. But none of this was ever passed across, not even in sort of simple briefing format. Today, where we know we've got, I mean, it should have been a list of the coordinates of all the AAA guns that we that were known about, the radar-guided AAA, where the Roland missile site was, where any other missile sites were. There wasn't one scrap of information passed. And so, actually, before the war broke out, I said to Hermes at a war conference, look, we've been experts in the air-to-air intercept and air combat role for some time now, and your guys haven't had the radars quite as long as we've done, haven't done the trials. So if there's going to be any split in the use of the aeroplane, like if there's going to be, which I hope there isn't, but quite a lot of surface attack, as well as air defense, and I want my squadron to be the air defense squadron because we're best at it. And this was agreed by the 800 squadron command in Hermes and by the captain in Hermes. When I asked that, Jeremy Black said to me, Sharkey, why did you ask that? Because I hadn't briefed my captain, he was sitting there. And I said, well, sir, I got a feeling that with Lynn Middleton being a bomber pilot, he will want to use a lot of Sea Harriers the wrong way for surface attack or ground attack. And we can't actually afford to get into that, because if we lose aircraft, we've only got 20. We can't afford to lose aircraft against low-value ground targets, nor do I want to lose my guys either. We're better at air defense. Let's stick to that. And he said, I'm delighted. You know, well, that's the way we'll do it. And it turned out to have been a very wise move to get us on that side, because if they'd started sending us stupid tasking notes for a lot of ground attack, I'd have basically had to say, no, we're not going to do it. How stupid. What's the flag trying to do? They never dared to send a... Actually, they did. On the day Sheffield was hit, they retasked some of my squadron's aircraft in the sky from their cat patrol station, not only to go on that surface search I've already mentioned to the southwest, away from Sheffield, but on other visual searches of local waters. And most of my pilots, well, all of them, none of them would stand up the same way as me, because I've been standing up quite a lot in the past, to the Admiral or anybody, and say, bloody no. I was taken. I wasn't taken. They told me, leave your cap station and go east, young man, basically. 100 miles, we have 2 enemy aircraft for you. And I thought, that's funny. Say again. They said vector 090, now 90 miles or 85 miles, 2 bogeys. We call it trade. That means he's saying, get out on that heading, which is the opposite direction to the threat, and intercept these 2 aircraft. And so I said, negative. They said, what? I said, negative. They can't be enemy aircraft. Short pause. From the Admiral, you are to vector 090. Trade now at 090, 85 miles. Get on with it. Negative. Check who's just taken off from your own deck. Well, I knew it wasn't one of our team taking off. I knew when our guys were taking off. Short pause, and they said, R. Roger, that is red section from HMS Hermes. Carry on with your combat air patrol. Now, if you weren't a bit of a bloody maverick like me, and also knowing what you were doing, we'd have gone towards the fleet. I mean, the ridiculous thing about this was that Hermes was 100 miles, okay? 090, and they were telling us to intercept these two aircraft at 85 miles. Yeah? And Invincible was also in fairly close company with Hermes. And it was so ridiculous because Invincible has sea dart and can knock out any enemy aircraft, or friendly or whatever, within 35, 40 miles. And so if they were enemy, why not engage them with sea dart? So that was sort of one thing in the brain. The other one was, they're coming out directly from Hermes. What the hell can they be? They're only friendlies, but the flag's got it wrong again. So anyway, they were very sort of not apologetic about it, but the pomposity went out of their RT then. But on the same day, what did they do? Robin Kent, my senior pilot, was out with Brian Haig. And these are not just stories out of my mind. Robin's was at the party. He's read the book. He agrees with everything I'm saying on these matters and remembers it as such as well. There was a fast-moving, low-level target seen on radar before Sheffield was hit. And one of the ships that had seen it, the radar pickets, you see there were three ships. There was Coventry in the north, Glasgow in the centre, Sheffield down the south, and three combat air patrol stations to the west of each ship. And Robin was on the northerly one, and I think it was Coventry. He said, we've got a fast-moving, low-level, intermittent contact. Vector so-and-so, in other words, a direction, for trade. Investigate. And so Robin set off with Brian, and almost immediately, Hermes, who'd been listening in on the RT, I said, negative, return to your cap station. We assess that target to be spurious. In other words, not a real target. From the distance from Hermes to the target, which Hermes couldn't possibly see, was about 130 miles. But they had the cheek to tell the cap what to do, countermining one of the ships. This is the Admiral's staff. There were aircraft being launched from Hermes on that day all over the bloody place. The reason we were actually there in the first place was so that she could launch an airstrike on Stanley and Goose Green, just as she'd done on May the 1st. On May the 1st, it was quite successful. There was naval gunfire bombardment in the middle of the night, followed by a Vulcan airstrike in the middle of the night, followed by a Sea Harrier attack on the airfields at dawn, much against my advice and so on. I wanted to do a Sea Harrier night attack. The first thing, in the middle of the night, no bombardment, nothing, just go and hit the airfield with all Sea Harriers. But Hermes weren't up to that. They didn't want to do it. They said it couldn't be done. We showed it could be done. We demonstrated before the war started, but they said no. So we weren't allowed to do that. That's what we wanted. So instead of that, they sent this bloody Vulcan all this way. Well, I mean, good. Nice long trip back. Special rules. You weren't allowed to shoot at anything while it was around. It really got me going. But anyway, they did that on day one. And what did the staff do on 4 days later? Exactly the same program of events. Naval gunfire bombardment first, then the Vulcan, then a dawn strike. Well, the weather wasn't adequate for the dawn strike. So the ships had moved in closer to Stanley because the Sea Harriers, fully bombed up, don't have as much range for going to a target and coming back as when they're carrying fuel tanks instead. And so we had to get moderately close. Well, we got in there, found the weather was bad, started to move back east again, and then the Admiral changed his mind and said, no, we'll stay put. Mistake number one. We were at this time conducting air combat patrol, and there were these three ships I've mentioned, Coventry, Sheffield and Glasgow, as the second line of air defence with their Sea Dart missile systems, as radar pickets on task. And that wasn't too bad. We could say, okay, well, we now have a real chance of being attacked by Etendards. Let's keep our radars online looking very closely, because there was a layer of low cloud down from about 2,000 feet downwards, which you had to look down through with your radar, which is no problem. That's what we were doing. But then Hermes and the Admiral started launching these Sea Harriers, not with weapons on necessarily, but from Hermes. They left us to do the air defense bit. And they were sending these aircraft off in all directions to do visual searches of local waters, you know. Occasional armed reconnaissance missions over the islands. In other words, they were having a bloody ball playing around doing nothing. But the worst thing was, Invincible had control of the air war. She was the anti-air warfare control ship, as designated by the Admiral. And as such, all air movements had to be approved and cleared by Invincible. But Hermes was launching their aircraft without telling Invincible how many, when, where, or where they were going. And there we were all sitting pretty edgy, waiting to be attacked, expecting Exocet attack. And there were lots of these aircraft flying around without any of the friendly units knowing who they were or where they were. And our radar emission in a Sea Harrier is very similar to that of an Etendard and to some of the ship's radars. And so by this stage, the Admiral hadn't said, don't use your radars to the Hermes crowd. And so these guys were going off and nobody knew where they were. So there were a lot of spurious warnings of maybe this is Etendard coming in. Because first of all, you get a bearing on a radar or get a contact on a radar contact or whatever. And you think, shit, that shouldn't be there. It's got to be enemy, you know. This went on all morning. And so there was that. A great confusion factor was put over the force by the flag launching all these aeroplanes. I'm sure it wasn't Hermes doing it. I'm sure it was the flag staff. But they're part of the same ship. And then they misdirected me and I refused to go. They took Robin off an intercept. And later they took the cap aircraft away to do visual searches. And that was a build-up to Sheffield being hit. Then, of course, shortly after that, later in the day, the weather cleared over the islands. And predictably, they went in to attack the same two targets. And that's when Nick Taylor was shot down. And so I'm pretty scathing about it all in my book, because it was the principles of war. One of them is don't be predictable. You know, use the element of surprise. Well, predictability is the opposite. And what the press now have taken out of the book and what we actually put forward in the press release for the book was basically isolating the Sheffield incident as a shining example of how things went wrong, and also the San Carlos bit of this high-level cap, why that contributed to the loss of Ardent and indirectly to the loss of the Coventry, because while these other Sea Harrier aircraft on the north, they usually had the northerly station there at San Carlos, while they were up there at high level, most of the attacks on San Carlos were coming through the north of Falkland Sound into San Carlos that way. And so poor old Commodore Mike Clapp had to decide what to do. And I think he and the Admiral between them decided to put, although the Admiral had no say in the matter really, it was Mike Clapp was in charge and did a brilliant job. He said, well, too many aircraft coming that way, I'm going to have to put a couple of ships up there as a missile trap to catch them on the way in. Now, if the Sea Harrier has been down at low level, there would have been no need to put Coventry there. None at all. But she had to go, and then she stayed. She did quite a good job. And then there came the nasty moment when aircraft came off the land and attacked her. Now, interestingly, I think you already know the story, do you not, Conrad, about Coventry steaming across Broadsword's Seawolf system so that she couldn't fire at the last minute.
I've heard it from other people, but...
Shall I go into that?
Please.
I forget the date for this. Maybe it's about the 26th of May. 25th, 26th, something like that. And this missile trap had been put out the previous day. And we'd seen them from our combat air patrols. And we said, oh, that's interesting. Hope they don't stay there too long. Next day, same position. They were just off Pebble Island. And we said in the crew room, for Christ's sake, somebody's got to move those ships. They're going to get hit. Because they were fairly close to the land. And the... their weapon systems on board these ships were designed for the open ocean, as you've heard before. And where you've got land clutter, the Sqdn missile system, for example, will not work. It'll work up there over land, but not at low level. And so anyway, they suddenly found themselves being approached by three A4s coming very fast off the land over Pebble Island from fairly short range, you know, 15, 20 miles, whatever. Now, at this stage, I think it was Neil Thomas's section from Hermes had been up there, were called down by the control ship. We've got a raid coming in towards Pebble Island, you know, have a go. And of course, they came down. They were actually did quite a good job to get nearly into a firing position on these A4s. But then they were called off by Coventry. He said, "I've acquired the targets on my Sqdn system. Break it off," which was our job. I mean, what you don't do is follow into a missile engagement zone if the ship's happy that they can take it with missiles. That's when Coventry's Sqdn system fell over. The clutter was too much or whatever, and it suddenly, I can't take them. So then, in broadsword, they had tried to get radar acquisition on the targets, and couldn't get it on the three A4s coming in. But then they got visual acquisition with their Sea Wolf. The Sea Wolf missile system can either be radar controlled onto a lock or by putting crosshairs of a television, a visual lock, which is then taken by the radar. And they locked up the targets, no problem. And so they said, thank God for that, you know. So they're now waiting to come in range, into the range of the Sea Wolf system, which isn't very long range, but it's a brilliant little missile. And just as they were coming, about to get into range, sitting there in the ops room in broadsword, they saw, instead of a nice clear sky over Pebble Island, these targets coming into them, the superstructure of Coventry steaming across their line of fire. And suddenly, that was it. There was no way they could fire. That's when Coventry was actually hit. And she capsized within 45 seconds. And David Hart Dyke, the captain of Coventry, and his team were absolutely wonderful the way they reacted. They were a very disciplined lot. And so the loss of life wasn't as great as it might otherwise have been. But my rather sort of indirect, my deduction that I think Woodward is going to fight with, Mike Clapp doesn't fight with it, the Commodore in charge of the area. He's read the book, he thinks I'm right. But my point really is that if they'd put the Sea Harrier caps in the right position in the first instance, which is on the deck where Coventry and Broadsword were supposed to be, in that area, there wouldn't have been all these attack aircraft coming through. Some would have got through, but not all. And there would have been no need to put Coventry up there. And that might be a pretty long-winded way of saying that, you know, I think they got it wrong there too, but I'll stick to my guns on it, because I think Ardent definitely was hit a second time because the Sea Harriers were at the wrong altitude, weren't ready down low level doing their job. And Coventry, because, again, you see, they were coming in, and on their own admission in a different book, Max Hastings' book, they were spending 10 minutes on task at medium and high level. Well, we were a long way from home base, from Hermes and Invincible, but 21st of May, when the protection had to start, when the landing started, my squadron was spending nearly 40 minutes at low level enduring on combat air patrol and then going back, and I told them, you get back on board with fuel that you didn't use and you didn't need to, and they kick your ass. And they all remember very